Chapter 19, First Man and Woman. The Elohim created man in their own image. The gods created men and women in their own image. Moses. Now that we know more about the creation of the world and the creator or creators of humanity, we can proceed to the myths about the origin of our species. It is clear from the myths that there have been multiple beginnings for the human race. These beginnings and endings may be called cycles. A spiral is a good symbol for these cycles. Rather than a circle that goes around and around, a spiral changes each time around. For history does repeat itself, but never in the same exact way. It is more like a rhyme than a repeat. Whether individually or collectively, we are always making choices, and each time we return to a different scenario, we either digress in a downward spiral or progress in an upward spiral. I am an optimist when it comes to God and humanity, and the hope is that we are getting better each time around. Long ago, say the myths, the earth was a beautiful garden wherein all animals lived in harmony. There was no fighting amongst humans nor beasts, for there was plenty for all. The animals could communicate with humans, and the humans communed with the gods. Some refer to this garden as Atlantis. According to the sleeping prophet Edgar Cayce, a man named Amelius led the hosts of people during this time. Cayce also claimed that Amelius later returned as Adam. According to Urantiism, two beings came to this earth to repopulate it 593-503 years ago, named Andon and Phanta. Many firsts. The Popol Vuh of the Mayans tells how the gods made humans first out of earth or mud, but the imperfections of the people caused a collapse of their civilization. Then the gods created people out of wood. This creation did not worship the gods and caused violence in the land. So the sky god, Hura Khan, ended this cycle by sending a flood. The post-flood remnants became the modern monkeys. Then the gods made the current race of people out of corn. The Aztecs and other Mesoamerican cultures refer to these cycles as the five suns. The first sun was ruled by Tezcatlipoca, but Tezcatlipoca was driven from the sky by Quetzalcoatl. In his anger, Tezcatlipoca had all humans devoured by jaguars. The second sun was ruled by Quetzalcoatl, but this creation did not honor the gods, so Tezcatlipoca turned them all into monkeys. Quetzalcoatl was saddened by their loss, so he swept the earth with a hurricane and stepped down as sun. He then created a new race of humans on earth. Tlaloc became the third sun ruler. His wife, Xochiquetzal, left him for Tezcatlipoca, so he neglected to send rain for the mortals. The people cried to Tlaloc for rain until he became angry and sent a rain of fire that destroyed the whole face of the earth. Then came the fourth sun cycle, ruled by Chalchiltlicue. Tezcatlipoca caused Chalchiltlicue to cry tears of blood for 52 years. Her tears flooded the earth and wiped out humanity. Once again, Quetzalcoatl recreates humans on the earth, this time by mixing his blood with the bones of previous civilizations, genetic engineering. Thus began our current sun age, ruled by Huitzilopochtli. The Hebrew Bible also has beings made of earth that are called Adam. Adam is a plural word that means mankind. This first creation of humans was not satisfactory to the gods, as they could not reproduce, so they were put to sleep. From their bone, possibly stem cells from the marrow, or rib, was created a new race of beings that could procreate. The mortals multiplied, but they forgot to worship the gods. So the storm god wiped them out with a flood. Out of the remnants of that creation sprang modern humans. Thus we see a repeating cycle of beings inhabiting the earth, To take it a step further, Mormon ritual has Lucifer in the Garden of Eden stating that he is only doing that which has been done on other worlds. In the Greek poem Works and Days, we are told of five ages, each corresponding to a different metal. First was the Golden Age, which was ruled by Cronus. As in the Adam story, these humans walked among the gods in a peaceful paradise. The humans of this age are now the guardians of humanity. Next came the Silver Age, ruled by Zeus. The humans under Zeus did not live as long as the previous race, and they took to fighting each other and stopped worshiping the gods. So Zeus had them killed off. For the Bronze Age, the gods created humans out of ash tree, which brings to mind Ask and Embla, the first man and woman in Norse myth, who Odin and his brothers created from the wood of an ash tree. It also lines up with the Mayan myth of people made from wood that were destroyed by flood. So too was the Bronze Age destroyed by Zeus, that is, by flood. Next was an age of heroes that died and went to Elysium, a paradise in the underworld. The last and current age is the Iron Age. It is the age of hard work and the survival of the fittest. It was said that the gods would completely abandon humans during this age because of their shameful actions. The Romans also designated these metals to the cycles of humanity. Historians adapted a similar system of minerals, beginning with the Stone Age and progressing on through the Copper Age, Bronze Age, etc. But rather than long periods that sequentially digress, it covers a relatively short time of progress made by modern humans. From the Norse Eddas, we learn of the development of the gods, followed by the creation of the first earthlings, called Ask and Embla. It is said that this cycle will end in a final battle that will kill the gods and all the humans of the earth. After all is consumed by fire, a new cycle is to begin with another Adam and Eve called Leif and Leifthrasir that will rebuild and repopulate the earth. Hinduism gives us a very detailed account of ages called Yugas. Satya is the first Yuga. In Satya, humans live with the gods. There is no agriculture because there is an abundance of everything. People live 4,000 years and grow very large. There is no religion because all live in truth and perfection. In the next Yuga called Treta, land is divided by wars and empires. People do not live as long nor grow as tall, and they have to work for their food. Climate also changes from moderate weather to seasonal extremes. In Dwapara, the third Yuga, disease enters the world and people only live a few hundred years. At the end of the last Dwapara, February 3102 BCE, Lord Krishna left the earth. The final age, or Yuga, is the Kali Yuga. This is an age of darkness, lies, and corruption. People will only live to around 70 years of age. Luckily, there is an end to this age. After all is destroyed by fire, a new Golden Age, or Satya Yuga, will begin. The four Yugas are a cycle that repeats, called a Mahayuga. The timelines and astronomical coincidences concerning each age, as well as time for the gods, can be found in the Puranas, like the Vishnu and Kalki Puranas. Before we leave this section, let's touch on the seven seals, or dispensations, from Christianity. Around 400 CE, St. Augustine wrote of the six ages of the world. The first began with Adam, second with Noah, Abraham III, David IV, the Babylonian captivity started the fifth, Jesus started the sixth, then comes the age of rest, or Sabbath. Other Christian denominations talk of dispensationalism. Each dispensation begins with the following events. 1. The Garden of Eden. 2. The Fall. 3. The Great Flood. 4. The Tower of Babel. 5. The Exodus. 6. The Atonement. 7. The Millennial Kingdom. For Latter-day Saints, the order goes Adam, Enoch, Noah, Moses, Jesus, Joseph Smith, who came to restore the truth and prepare the way for the second coming of Jesus and the subsequent 1,000 years of peace. Here is a passage from a Kabbalistic book called the Zohar. Happy are those who will be left alive at the end of the sixth millennium to enter the Shabbat, which is the seventh millennium. For that is a day set apart for the Holy One on which to effect the union of new souls with old souls in the world. The 6,000-year scenario has been problematic because many believed it to be the time the earth was created rather than the time a new breed of humans was created. Science has shown that the earth is roughly 4.6 billion years old, which matches better with the 4.32 billion earth years equal to one day of Brahma. As 1,000 years is a day to God in Abrahamic religions, 24,000 years is a day to the Deva gods in Hinduism. This is close to the 25,772 years in a full precession of the equinox, the sun moving backward through the 12 constellations of the zodiac, which was observed in ancient India. LDS leader Parley Pratt wrote, "Eternity, agreeably to the records found in the catacombs of Egypt, has been going on in this system almost 2,555 millions of years. That is, an eternity lasts 2.5 billion years. The 7,000-year cycle can also be called a God year. 7,000 Earth years times 365 God days times 1,000 equals 2,555 million Earth years. So if people have reached great heights over and over for billions of years on this planet, what exactly happened 6,000 years ago? Well, as discussed in the God of Water chapter, civilization popped up relatively overnight. Reading, writing, agriculture, architecture, commerce, art, metallurgy, all around 6,000 years ago. Another scientific discovery is that one person around 6,000 years ago was born with a mutation for no evolutionary cause at all and became the first person to have blue eyes rather than brown. The gene known as HERC2 was altered and in turn alters the OCA2 gene to cause blue eyes. Because of the uniformity of the genes in this haplogroup, researchers have concluded that blue eyes come from one common ancestor 6 millennia ago. It was the A111T mutation of the SLC24A5 gene in chromosome 15 that caused light skin in Europeans 7,000 years earlier, 1300 BCE, in the area between the Black and the Caspian Seas. This is not to say that one eye color or skin color is better than another. It is to show that significant changes occurred. Interestingly, all but Black Africans carry Neanderthal genes. The Neanderthals were a large race of Homo sapiens that predated our own. They lived from 400,000 years ago up until 40,000 years ago, grew red hair, and had larger brains. According to popular science, Homo sapiens, us, appear in the fossil record around 200,000 years ago in Africa, and we migrated to other continents 60,000 years ago. The mixture of Neanderthal DNA and the survival of the blue eye gene are unsolved mysteries that may have been caused by outside intervention. There is evidence of splicing in our DNA similar to what we see in our own genetically modified organisms. From the geologic record, modern science outlines 6 mass extinction events that have occurred on the Earth: the Ordovician, Silurian, Late Devonian, Permian Triassic, Triassic Jurassic, Cretaceous Paleogene, and the Holocene extinction that is currently happening. Some of the commonalities among these myths or beliefs include a state of peace and longevity, destruction by water, and then by fire, and all of them describe earlier beings that were enormous in size. Giants. Stories of large humanoids have been told throughout the world, and up until recently, they were believed. Some say the current unbelief is due to the Smithsonian conspiring to destroy all evidence that conflicts with current ideas about evolution. This may or may not be true, but there is plenty of evidence that the people of the world were telling the truth when they talked about giants. LDS prophet Joseph Smith and two apostles claimed to see a vision of two beings with white hair and clothed in white garments. They were the two most beautiful and perfect specimens of mankind he ever saw. Joseph said, "They are our first parents, Adam and Eve." Adam was a large, broad-shouldered man, and Eve, as a woman, was as large in proportion. A similar belief in Islam is that people who enter paradise will look alike and will resemble their father Adam in stature, 60 cubits tall. The first humans, according to Hinduism, grew to 21 cubits in height. The first beings in Norse myth were the giant race. Same goes for the Greeks. Pre-flood people in the Judeo-Christo-Islamic Bible, as well as in the Mesopotamian writings, were bigger and lived longer. A number of post-Diluvian giants were also reported. Goliath was said to be 4 cubits and a span, or 6 feet 9 inches. Many giants east of the Mediterranean Sea were killed by the Israelites. In the Book of Enoch, we learn about the Watchers that were referred to as giants in the Bible and the Book of the Giants from the Dead Sea Scrolls. Their children were given 7,000 years to prove themselves. And the Lord said unto Michael, "Go, bind Semjaza and his associates who have united themselves with women. Bind them fast for 70 generations in the valleys of the earth, till the day of their judgment." Enoch 10:11, 14. Red-haired giants from 7 to 12 feet tall were found living in caves in what is now the western United States and were exterminated by North American tribes, according to their own claims. Names. In Western cultures, the first man and woman are known as Adam and Eve. They talked to a snake, ate some fruit, made aprons, left paradise, and had some kids. To some, they are seen as the cause of all that is bad in life, and to others, like the Mormons, they are venerated as wise beings that made this school of life possible. As stated above, Adam means men. It also refers to the ruddy color of the clay he was made of. Adam named his wife Eve, as she is the mother of all living. Eve, in Hebrew, is Hawa and means source of life. Hawa, also rendered Chava or Chawat, was a title given to Asherah, the Canaanite mother of the gods, the Elohim. The Hurrian goddess Hepat was also known as the mother of all living. Thus, Eve is a goddess akin to Mother Earth or Mother Nature. The fact that Eve means source of life synchronizes her with the fountain of life and the tree of life in the garden. Further connections can be made with the second Adam and Eve of the Norse that are called Leif, life, and Leifthrasir, zest for life, as well as the Mesopotamian story it was taken from. In Sumerian, Ti means both life and rib. It appears that the Adam and Eve story that we all know came from a much older myth from the area of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, for many parallels exist between them. One such parallel is the mention of the Tigris and Euphrates as part of Eden in the Genesis account. In the Sumerian myth, the goddess Ninhursag, who is known as the source of all life on earth, created a beautiful garden called Eden. It was a paradise with fruit trees and vegetables that was to the east of Sumer, beyond the sea. That would mean it was in the land of the Aryans, Persia, and the Indus Valley. Adam and Eve were eastward in Eden. The goddess placed the animals and plants of the garden in the care of her husband Enki. According to Zechariah Sitchin, Enki was the geneticist that created domesticated food and animals, including modern people, and the garden was a controlled habitat for genetic modification. Enki ate of the plants of the garden and felt the pain in his rib. So Ninhursag, from Enki's seed, gave birth to 8 goddesses, which healed him. One of these daughters was Ninti, meaning Lady of Life, or Lady of the Rib. Thus, Eve corresponds to both Ninti and Ninhursag, because she is the life from the rib, and because she is the mother of all living. There are, of course, many points on which these myths differ, but here are some more similarities. Enki created a mortal son named Adapa in the Garden of Eden in Delmun. Adapa helped Enki in the garden, but later left Eden and became the first sage or high priest of the Eridu temple. His titles include Apkalu, a title given to the seven sages Enki sent into the world, and Uwana, or as the Greek historian Berosus called him, Oannes. Partaking of the fruit. Adapa was in trouble for breaking the wings of a goddess, so he was taken up to the council of the gods. Before going, Enki warned him not to partake of the food in the heavenly place. So Adapa went before the gods and frankly told them what he had done. Because of his honesty, Anu decided to offer him the food of immortality rather than the food of death. Thinking it would kill him, Adapa declined and returned to Earth as a mortal. Adam then corresponds to both Enki and Adapa. Enki eats plants from the garden and has pain in his rib. Adapa refuses the food of eternal life and leaves as a mortal. Adam refuses the fruit of knowledge at first, but then partakes and becomes mortal. Adam is then unable to eat the fruit of life, immortality. The idea has been postulated in this book that our planet Earth may be the lower world or underworld to which beings have been cast down. With that in mind, the following myths link even more to the Genesis account. Persephone ate the food of the underworld and as a result was bound to live there. The mother goddess of Shinto, Izanami, also ate food in the land of Yellow Springs, Yellow River of China, and was unable to return. Shikik lived in the Mayan underworld, Xibalba, where she found a tree bearing skull-shaped fruit. A god told her to eat the fruit, and she did. As a result, Shikik became pregnant with the Hero twins. According to Brigham Young, Adam and Eve came to this earth from a different planet, and they brought seeds with them to plant here. As they partook of the apples, the plums, the figs, etc. that grew here, their bodies became mortal from its effects, and Adam and Eve lived the rest of their mortal lives on Earth. It is said that all hardships in life are a result of Adam and Eve eating the forbidden fruit. This links Eve with the first woman in Greek mythology. Just like the Bible story, androgynous people lived on the Earth before a separate gender was created. Zeus was angry about Prometheus helping humans, so he had Pandora, all gifts, created and sent her to Earth with a jar, Pandora's box, that she was not to open. Pandora's curiosity got the best of her, and she opened the jar, and out came pain, fear, anger, and all other ills that now plague the Earth. Pandora married Epimetheus, Prometheus's brother, who appears to be the first mortal man of an earlier age. The one thing left in Pandora's jar was hope, just as Eve was told that through her seed was the hope of a savior. Before becoming mortal, Adam and Eve ate freely of the tree of life. A mythical peach tree gave life to the gods in China. Immortality was gained for Zoroastrians in the next life by drinking from the Homa plant. In Hinduism, the plant is called Soma, and its juice is extracted and ritually consumed for vitality. The gods of Iceland ate golden apples for immortality. The Greek goddess Hera had a garden in the west that grew golden apples. The Celts believed that in order to enter the underworld without dying, one must possess a golden apple. In Mesopotamia, the Apkalu pluck pine cones from the tree of life. Tree of life. We have mentioned that the trees and poles have been used to symbolize the goddess in ancient cultures. Eve is the matriarch of our family tree. Thus, she is symbolized by the Asherah tree, or female columns. The totem poles of North America and the tiki poles of Polynesia are records of family histories and in honor of ancestral deities. As the result of fruit and seeds falling from trees, new life is born from the womb of the earth. Thus, a clear connection is made between the tree of life and the act of procreation. So all the people that said the eating of the fruit by Eve and then Adam was a euphemism for sex were correct. There were two trees in the Garden of Eden, one of life and one that brought death. They symbolize two opposite poles, just as the two pillars of King Solomon's temple that were carved like trees bearing pomegranates and were named Jachin and Boaz. The pillars represented mercy and justice, or the opposite sides of a scale. The balance, or equilibrium, of the two is represented in the sacred symbols of all faiths. See Chapter 52, Duality. It is the union of opposites that creates something new and beautiful. This is a universal law and applies to many things, including copulation of men and women. Opposite poles intertwine as a double helix in DNA, the building blocks of life. This is why the gods that created humans are accompanied by motifs such as a staff with entwined serpents, or as a male and a female with serpentine lower bodies that intertwine. Another symbol associated with these gods that has the same connotation is the Tree of Life, which has a central trunk and a row of branches on either side. The Tree of Life has to do with genetics and the creation of life. It is also seen as the Axis Mundi, a world tree or pole that runs through the center of the world and the center of the cosmos. In ancient symbology, the roots of the tree extend to the underworld, where a serpent is coiled, and the branches reach up to the heavens, where a bird is perched. Humans live in the middle or trunk region. Of the Earth. The Indian goddess Parvati created Ganesh from clay. When a great man is sent to repopulate the earth, he is called Manu, which means man, just as the word Adam. With the permission of the goddess Namu, Enki and Ninhursag created humans in the image of the gods by mixing earth with divine blood. The first man and son of Enki was Adapa. Adapa was the first sage and teacher in the temple. The gods made Adam of the dust of the earth and the breath of life. Adam was created in their image. Yahweh made Eve from the bone of Adam. Adam made the first altars for worship. Prometheus created humans out of clay, and Demeter breathed life into them. Later, Hephaestus made Pandora from clay. Prometheus had a son named Deucalion, who created the first cities, built the first temples, and reigned as the first ruler. The Egyptian god Khnum is the creator of humans, which he fashions from the clay of the Nile. The first man was Atum, and he was the first pharaoh. According to native tribes of northwestern America, Earthmaker took soft clay and formed the figure of a man and a woman, then many men and women, which he dried in the sun and into which he breathed life. They were the first people. In Central America, Kukulkan of the Maya, or Quetzalcoatl of the Aztecs, with his wife Cihuacoatl, created people out of mud or earth. Later, people were made from bone and divine blood. In South America, the being that created humans out of earth is called Viracocha by the Inca. In Africa, the Yoruba tell of Obatala, who is the shaper of humans from clay. He gave them life with his breath. Obatala was also the first man and ruler. He was king of the city Ife with his main wife Yemu. In China, humans were made of the yellow clay of the Yellow River by Fuchi and Nua. They were considered the first father and mother of the human race. Tane Mahuta, Lord of the Forest, is the Maori god that created the first woman from soil. He experimented with other life forms at first, and then created a wife for himself from the earth. The first man that Tane created was Tiki. Tane made a clay image of himself, added his blood to it, and breathed the breath of life into it. Variations of this story come from New Zealand to the Hawaiian Islands and all of the Polynesian islands in between. In one version, Tiki creates himself. In another, Tane and his brothers all make Tiki with clay and spit. Mari Koriko was the wife of Tiki. The gods are always said to have come from the sky and then to have created modern people from the elements of the earth, sometimes from clay, sometimes from crushed bone. Often, blood from the sky people is added in the process. The clay and bone can be seen as what the gods had to work with, be that fossil remains or live humanoids of the time. Bone and blood both contain DNA, which, with the proper technology, can be combined to make new variations in the gene pool. These changes tend to happen every 7,000 years. Some say that the planet Nibiru comes every 3,600 years and changes are made at these times. Be that as it may, there are also those that are assigned to constantly watch over this planet. According to mainstream scientists, the oldest temple that we know of is Göbekli Tepe in Turkey. It was built at least 12,000 years ago. Then, 6,000 years ago, human technology jumped from arrowheads to the arts and sciences that we use today. Since the modern discovery of electricity, flight, and rockets, we have begun a transition into a space age. It won't be long before we turn off the aging gene and become immortal ourselves. Various ancient depictions of humans being created in a jar have been discovered across the world. We find images of Enki and Ninma, Ninhursag, with a jar, two serpents, and the tree of life as they fashion bodies. We read the Yazidi description of Azazil placing Adam's seed in a jar to create a son named Shahid bin Jer, whom the Yazidi claim as their ancestor. This is not a far stretch considering we have been making test tube babies for decades. In vitro fertilization involves fertilizing an egg in a laboratory dish and after some growth implanting it in a woman's uterus. Adam God theory and the divine couple. Many of the mythical first ancestors were also considered to be gods. In Shinto, Izanagi and Izanami are the parents of the gods and of humanity. In Taoism, Fuchi and Nuwa are divinities and our first parents. This divine couple story has interesting parallels with the Jewish story. Fuchi was one of the three sovereigns that brought civilization to the earth. He and Nuwa lived around 5,000 years ago. They felt ashamed after mating, so they made fans of grass to cover their faces. When Adam and Eve tasted the forbidden fruit, they also felt ashamed and covered their loins with leaves. Both stories have snake imagery, a major river, cultivation of the earth, beings made out of either red clay or yellow clay, and the first man dying at an old age. Some of the other myths of gods that progenerated humanity have already been mentioned above. The Egyptian god Atum was married to Iusaset. She was called his wife, sister, and shadow. In other words, she emanated from him, just as Eve came from Adam's rib. The ancient people along the Nile believed that their rulers descended from these gods.
Further south,
this divine ancestral couple was called Amun and Mut. And again, they were Ra and Hathor, or Ta and Sekhmet. Each of these couples go back to the beginning of creation, and the goddess of the pair is the wife, sister, and daughter of the god. Either they were confused, or there was a special connection between the two, like genetic engineering. In the LDS temple ceremony, a trinity of gods named Elohim, Jehovah, and Michael decide to create a new planet from the raw materials in space. It is said elsewhere that we all took part in this creation. After the Earth is created, Michael comes down as the man Adam and the father of the human race. This makes Adam both a creator god and the first man. Like the Egyptian creator god Etim or Atum, he is the finisher of creation, the father of humans, and the one who brings it to an end. As Joseph Smith said, Adam holds the keys of this temporary state and will reclaim them from Jesus at the end time. The following is a quote from Brigham Young on the topic. Just like the practice of polygamy, this doctrine was later abolished by the church. When our father Adam came into the Garden of Eden, he came into it with a celestial body and brought Eve, one of his wives, with him. He helped to make and organize this world. He is Michael, the archangel, the Ancient of Days, about whom holy men have written and spoken. He is our Father and our God, and the only God with whom we have to do. Some LDS leaders did not like the idea of becoming mortal again after achieving immortality, even though that meant that they would populate their own world. So Young replied, "Whether Adam is the personage that we should consider our Heavenly Father or not is considerable of a mystery to a good many. I do not care for one moment how that is. It is no matter whether we are to consider him our God or whether his father or his grandfather. For in either case, we are of one species, of one family." The Bible says that Adam is the son of God. The Babylonians say that Adapa is the son of the god Enki. The Greeks say Deukalion is the son of Prometheus, and we are left with the conclusion that we are gods, children of the Most High. Psalm 82:6. Bloodlines. It would make sense that a group of scientists that wanted to create a new species and then observe its evolution would make more than one colony to account for variables such as environment, mutations, and crossbreeding. Perhaps this is what the gods did when they placed modern people in the fertile regions of the Earth. That is one explanation for the various first man and woman myths of the world. Another is that all myths came from the same source. As for the Adam and Eve myth, there are many interpretations of how their seed was propagated. The Bible gives only two male children. Apocryphal works add daughters through which incestuous breeding can occur. But how Cain found a wife among the people of Nod, even though no one else had been born yet, is not explained. This is, however, in harmony with other myths that tell of pre-Adamite people that lived before and during the time of the first man. Eve tasted the fruit first with Lucifer, Azazel, and according to some Gnostics, bore Cain as a result. Later on, Adam ate the fruit with Eve, and they had Abel. According to the Yazidi, Azazel made a clone of Adam named Son of Ajar. Adam and Eve then had Seth, who had the exact likeness of his father. Jewish sources say that Adam was espoused to Lilith before Eve was created, which gives us another possible bloodline. Adam and Lilith bear similarities with Enlil and Ninlil of Sumerian myth, not just in name, but also as a divine couple sent to Earth where they bear children. The serpent Lucifer is told that there will be enmity between his seed and the seed of the woman, thus telling us that Lucifer has children on the earth. The first edition of the King James Bible contained a pedigree chart of the human family tree with illustrations of serpents alongside the bloodline of Cain. Azazel and his companions introduce their seed into the gene pool again later in the story. We should remember, however, that we are one human family and our blood has been mixing for a long time. We are not originally of this world. We all descend from the gods and are, in a sense, alien to Earth. Strangers in a strange land. The Fall. For many, the fall refers to the time when evil came into the world as a result of Adam and Eve's disobedience. But here, a controversial look at the fall is given. We begin with Adam, a god that came to the earth to multiply and replenish it. But his actions were contrary to the law given by his god, and his sin or transgression caused him to fall. From what? Grace? He fell from the heavenly presence of the gods. Surely he had wise reasons for this. Adam fell that men might be, and men are, that they might have joy. But we have heard this story before. A high-ranking god named Lucifer disobeyed his god and fell to the earth. He became the god of this earth and shared the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil with a woman, meaning he mated with a mortal. Both were gods. Both fell and became the Lord of Earth. This suggests that Adam and Lucifer are one and the same. We will continue with this idea in the Savior chapter, where it comes to a reasonable yet outrageously blasphemous conclusion. Enlil was cast out of heaven for sleeping with a woman on Earth. Azazel, Prometheus, and other gods mentioned in the previous chapter were all said to have fallen to the Earth for mixing their seed with the people of Earth and helping them become as the gods. First man and woman, India, Manu and Shatarupa, Persia, Mashya and Mashyana, Sumerian Babylon, Adapa and Aruru, Judea, Adam and Eve, Greece and Rome, Epimetheus and Pandora, Celtic, Dwyfan and Dwyfach, Norse, Ask and Embla, also Leif and Leifthrasir, Egypt, Atum and Usaset, Nigeria, Kamunu, Peru, Manco Capac and Mama Uklu, Yucatan, Maya, Xpiacoc and Xmucane, Mexico, Aztec, Cipactonal and Ohomoco, also Nata and Nena, Mongolia, Ehrlich, China, Taoism, Fuchi and Nuwa, Japan, Shinto, Izanagi and Izanami, Australia, Ankotaringa, New Zealand, Tiki and Marikoriko, Hawaii, Wailahila Ninui, Arabia, Islam, Adam, and Hawa.